Hello, my name is Janis Thiemann and I work at the Communication Networks Institute at TU Dortmund University. Today I'm going to present our work, Celidon supporting first responders through 3D AOA-based ultra-wideband ad hoc localization. What you are seeing here is the view of a firefighter in a low or no visibility environment. Here, firefighters are often not even able to see their own hand in front of their eyes. This is what we are going to address in this work. First, some statistics. Breathing apparatus operations are exhausting and dangerous. Here, obviously, low or no visibility is one of the key issues with those operations. Generally, safety is ensured by protocol, but unforeseen incidents, such as falling objects or other obstacles or even explosions nearby, you name it, are part of real-world situations. And what we can do is we can prevent separations or the loss of orientation, because this is the cause for some of the accidents and, in the worst case, the death of some firefighters. On the upper right-hand side, you can see some statistics over the years gathered by our partner at the Institute of Fire Service and Rescue Technology here in Dortmund. And you can see the numbers are not vastly large, but they are still there. So it's an issue worth addressing. So how do we address this issue? The Celidon approach, it's a mixture of an augmented reality overlay in the firefighters' masks and the information gathered by the ad hoc localization that we are going to present in this work. In order to even get some useful information, you need to know where is your partner. So what we are going to look at is the relative localization required to display this information. So how do we achieve this infrastructure-free ad hoc localization? We are building upon ultra-wideband communication technology, which is capable of providing us with precise time of arrival estimation. We are capable of obtaining the ranges by using two-way ranging. In this specific case, symmetric double-sided two-way ranging, which is utilizing another message or an additional message in order to cancel out the individual clock drifts of the participating nodes. But what's rather new about this setup is that we are also obtaining the angle of arrival estimation. And we are doing this not by placing several modules, like in the picture on the right-hand side, and taking the range differences or the TOA difference. We are using a phase difference of arrival approach there. And because of this phase difference of arrival approach, the module that we are building can get much smaller. In this case, the distance between the antennas is around 2 centimeters, and this enables us to make really practically very small modules that are easily integrated into the firefighters' clothes. So let's have a look at the principle of measurement for the 3D PDOA concept. The phase difference of arrival estimation in this case is based on the received channel impulse responses. What we get from the transceiver modules is the correlated channel impulse response data, which is practically the accumulator data correlated with the reference pulse of the ultra wideband communication system. And you can see on the right-hand side that you get the I and the Q component samples, and through this you can compute the IQ magnitude. Further, you get the accumulator index at which the transceiver estimated the first path of the arriving signal. So what you do is you take the phase, as it is depicted in the lower plot, and you can take the phase at this specific index. In order to obtain a phase difference, though, you need two of those. Further, it should be noted that there's also some fine correction using special registers on the transceivers, which help improve the estimation and take out some noise. This is the hardware platform that we developed to validate this concept and ultimately to enable the firefighters to localize themselves. On the right-hand side, you can see the main node PCB for the node that is estimating the ranges and the phase difference of arrivals. There you can see that there are three ultra-wideband transceivers on the PCB. The middle one, easily identified by the red LED that is blinking, is the one that is actively conducting the two-way ranging, and the two outer ones are passively listening to all the signals that that arrive at the transceivers. We have a centralized integrated clock distribution and the option to feed in alternative clock sources. Further, we have a somewhat high stability temperature controlled crystal oscillator and a controller, microcontroller unit, which is capable of piping all the required information to a host PC in order to evaluate the results. In this specific setup, we used antenna connectors and rigid cables so that we can evaluate different antenna arrangements and constellations and also antenna types. So we wanted to be flexible there, and this is what you can see on the left-hand side. This is the constellation that we used throughout the following experiments, but there are other constellations and also other antenna patterns possible that may improve the angle estimation results in the future. Let's have a look at the topology for the overall system used in the following evaluations. I would like to start on the right-hand side of this figure, where you can see the mobile node. For the mobile node, we used the same PCB as just presented, but only with a single transceiver equipped. It might also be possible to use one with more transceivers or to kind of form a chain of those three transceiver systems, but for simplicity, we just equipped a single transceiver, as this is totally sufficient for the evaluations that we did. Then you can see, when you look at the RF front end of this transceiver, that it's talking to three other transceivers in the Celidon Cerberus node. And here, as mentioned before, you have one node or one transceiver that is conducting active two-way ranging and two transceivers that are passively listening. Obviously, those transceivers need to be tightly clock synced, and this is done using a clock buffer and a sync distribution. The transceivers in turn are controlled by a microcontroller unit, which then is in turn controlled by an embedded PC capable of logging the data and also interfacing with a mask for information display. Let's have a look at the experimental evaluation conducted in order to evaluate the accuracy of the proposed system. In the first step, we varied the azimuth angle, then the dependency on the rotation of the mobile unit, and there's also a small experiment covering the elevation accuracy. It should be noted that in this experimental setup, we used a motion capture system as a reference. You might even see the motion capture markers on the helmet there. And the PDOA measuring node is on a static position, close by the large LCD monitor on the left-hand side in this video. Let's start with the variation of the azimuth angle. This is done using half-circle movements around the static PDOA measuring node, as visible in the small video on the upper left-hand side. The corresponding time series is visible on the right side of this slide. It starts on the top with the azimuth angle. Here the ground truth is depicted in red, and the raw results are depicted in gray, and the filtered results are depicted as the black line on the gray raw results. It's visible that the raw results and also the filtered results are capable of tracking this azimuth movement pretty well. Similarly, the elevation variation, which is depicted in the time series below, is not varying much, as the person is not varying the elevation angle much. The distance is also almost static, and the rotation of the tag in the lowest time series is varying according to the orientation of the person, As it's also visible on the, in the small video. When we look at the lower left corner, we see a graph featuring the measured azimuth angle and the ground truth azimuth angle, which is obtained by the motion capture system. And also there, it's pretty visible that the tracking is working pretty well. Generally, the performance is suitable for obtaining the azimuth angle. In the next evaluation, we have a look at the elevation angle. The movement that is used obtaining the results there is depicted in the video on the upper left-hand side. And the corresponding time series is visible on the right-hand side. Here, it's practically the opposite of the experiment that was shown just before. The azimuth angle is kept almost static, and the elevation angle varies corresponding to the movement that is visible in the video. Also, it should be noted that the distances for this movement are varied, which is depicted in the distance graph below. Here you can see that with the larger distance, the up and down movement is not influencing the distance much, but as you get close to the POI measuring node, the distance is also varying accordingly. On the lower left-hand side, you can also see a graph where the measured elevation angle is compared to the ground truth elevation angle. And also here, it's visible that the system is capable of tracking this elevation pretty well. In the next experiment, we focus on the rotation of the mobile unit. The experiment to do this is illustrated in the video on the upper left-hand side. The corresponding time series also here on the right-hand side. And you can see that there is a small variation in the azimuth angle, but it's not that large. You see some small spikes, but it's not that large. Similar, it is with the elevation angle, which can be tracked pretty well. In the distance graph, which is below that, you can see the offset of the antenna to the helmet. It's sticking a little bit out to the front, so you see the rotation as a variation of the distance value there, and this carries out throughout the whole experiment. The distribution function of the error that is obtained in the azimuth is illustrated on the lower left corner. Here you can see that the azimuth error is pretty much within minus 15 to plus 15 degrees, which suffices for the accuracy needs there. In order to get an estimate for the overall resulting positioning accuracy for the conducted experiments that we just saw, we calculated the resulting position based on the elevation and azimuth angles and the estimated distances, and provided a distribution function of this on the right-hand side. Here you can see the raw and the filtered results, and what's also visible is that the 3D accuracy is better than 30 centimeters for the 75% quantile, and for challenging situations where high reliability is required, we look at the 99% quantile, and we can see that the accuracy here is also in the range of 60 centimeters, which gives us a pretty high confidence in what we can expect from this system. Obviously, the filtered results are slightly better, especially with canceling out those large outliers that you would need for the 99% quantile. But generally, it can be stated that the accuracy, or the achievable accuracy, is pretty good there. So where to go from here? In order to make the effect of this approach visible and show how this can be integrated into practical operations, we created a small visualization for for the ad hoc localization. On the lower left hand side, you can see a small video showing a mini demo of this in real time. And on the upper right hand side, you can see an annotated version of this visualization. So every localized participant, we create an extra arrow for, and this arrow is oriented based on the azimuth angle that is measured by the localization system. Further, the distance to the participant that is localized is shown as a value below the identifier of the localized object, and then we have additional information that might be helpful for the conduction of the mission on the upper right hand side and on the lower right hand side. For example, mission duration, battery status, health data such as heartbeat or other information. This visualization is intentionally kept simple in order to enable smooth integration into the actual operation, because you cannot overload the personnel there with too much data. So the things that get displayed on the augmented reality display here are white, and everything that is black is not visible to the person since it's not emitting any light. The firefighter practically has an overlay, sees those two arrows with A and B, and sees the distances and the rough direction of where the participants are. Okay, let's come to the conclusion. So this work presented an ultra-wideband-based ad hoc localization approach for firefighters using phase difference of arrival. We laid out a system concept and presented a functional prototype for the proposed approach, and we also conducted experimental evaluation featuring multiple mobility patterns in order to evaluate the different aspects of the location accuracy. We could show that the resulting positioning accuracy is within the range to be sufficient of providing mission critical relative location information, and we also could show an early prototype of a visualization that could aid the firefighters in doing so. Future work might incorporate the evaluation of different antenna constellations and patterns in order to further increase the achievable accuracy and reliability of the system. Further, we are working on a wireless link to an in-mask display that is then capable of seamlessly integrating into the masks of the firefighters in order to display augmented reality information there. The next step will also feature integration and practical field evaluation in order to work and improve the aspects that are mission critical to the firefighters, and iterate in order to improve the overall system performance. Okay, thank you for your attention. If you have further questions regarding this presentation or regarding the general topic, please feel free to contact us or ask the questions in the Q&A session after this talk. Thank you.